So symbols are not covered very well in the textbook, but what we're going to try to do is get familiar with symbols, because the new PLCs refer to these as tags. I think 500 refers to it comments. I think they call them descriptions also, so there's two little bit of differences. But symbols, we can assign them before we start. I think I showed y'all a little bit about that. Oops. But we can also assign them on the fly. PLC ladder logic. So I should have gave y'all out a copy of the rules, right? Didn't I give y'all a copy of those? Rule one, you get an error that you'll have to figure out to get rid of it. Input instructions must be placed between L1. So we know L1 is what we call the left vertical rail, right? You'll understand that. And then L2 is the right vertical rail. And then our circuits are programmed between L1 and L2. Inputs on the left, outputs on the right. Rule two, with our logic, output instructions are placed between the rungs control devices in L2. Nothing is allowed between the rung output instruction and L2. Now, an output is required for every rung. Well, actually, for every line. For every rung. Got to have at least one output. We can't put outputs in series, but we can put them in parallel inside the rung. Outputs are required, inputs are not. In this class, though, we will have inputs in everything. So here we'll have inputs, but we do have some instructions that we want executed without any condition to be without any condition being made. And I'll probably show y'all that. But inputs are on the left, so they're between L1 and the rung load or loads. And then outputs are on the right. In RS Logic 500, it usually puts the instruction in the right place for you, either on the left or the right, unless you tell it to do otherwise. All input instructions must be placed horizontal. You don't have to worry about that. This is automatic. I've never seen a PLC programming application that requires you. When we draw relay logic, it's required that we draw them horizontal. But in PLCs, the inputs are put the way they're supposed to be. Rule four, with RS Logic 500, a rung's output instruction must not be placed in series with other output instructions. Multiple rung output instructions can only be placed in parallel with another line. One output instruction per line, one or more output instruction per rung. There are no multi-load series circuits allowed. This rule doesn't apply to RS Logic 500, but or 5000. What you need to know, it always works. So instead of trying to remember, okay, is it allowed in this one and not allowed in that one, then it's highly likely that if you don't put multiple output instructions in series, you'll be okay on all these things. Rule five, programs flow execution from L1 to L2. Rung numbers are automatically placed on the left side of each rung's line, so you don't have to worry about rule six because that's automatic. Rule seven, this is user defined, this is not automatic. Each input and output instruction's address is entered above each instruction symbol. The location is predefined by the ladder logic programming application. Note that relative to RS Logic 500, once an address for a bit instruction is entered at the top of the symbol, the bit address is displayed below the symbol. A block input or output instruction's logical address is entered in a predefined location inside the device's symbol. So we're going to start off using three or basically four basic symbols. One, two, three, five basic symbols. One of them we'll get into later. But we're going to use this symbol right here. And this is a normally open or an examine if closed. This is a normally closed or examine if open. This is going to represent a coil, but it's not really a coil, it's virtual inside the PLC. Then we're going to get into two more. This is going to be a latch instruction, which you will get out, and this is going to, U is going to be an unlatch. Now these are the only input-output instructions we're going to start off with. But when we get into timers, we're going to move to block instructions. So they're going to come up and look like this. And then we'll come up here. So a timer, like T4, and we'll look at that. This may be a timer. And then most of your counter instructions will start off with C5. And these will be all that we'll talk about in this. These are all output instructions that we'll see. These are our input instructions that we'll start off with. Oops, I went too far, guys. So these are our input instructions right here for this class. And these are our output instructions that we'll deal with in this class. So the two symbols we'll deal with on the first, these will be automatically put on the left, toward the left, and your output instructions, if you don't manually try to insert it in there, of course it'll give you an error. These should automatically jump up on the right, on the LT side. And each one of them is going to be assigned an address. So when we key in the address, we might start off with I, which tells the PLC it's an input instruction. And this is true even on Siemens, by the way. But the syntax after that is a little different. For OSLogic 500, we'll put a colon next. And then we'll put what we call the slot number. Now technically, the slot number on internal input or output ports is slot 0. On a modular PLC, the first output you might have would be in slot 1, because in a modular PLC, the CPU occupies slot 0. On these PLCs, whether they're hybrid, which is what I called it, so if you got one of the 1000s, if you look on the right-hand side, it's got a little door on the side, which we could knock out and then add multiple modules onto this PLC. The 1100, we could add up to four different modules on the right hand side. If you're on one of the 1000s, which are the little suitcase trainers, you can't add anything to those, because those are fixed PLCs. So we can't do anything. What you buy, what you got is what you see is what you get. So when we start typing this up, and we'll look at this later, the syntax is the type of instruction. So like I, and then let's don't even put that. Let's just put, so instead of me cramming it all on this one, let me just insert a new slide. Wouldn't you know it? In fact, let's just go down and look at it so I don't have to. This is not in the textbook. This is right out of the actual manual that goes with the 1100 PLC. and you have access to this. So what's nice about this, all the documents, so you might get a PLC, and when it comes in a box, it's going to have a little slip of paper with it. It's not going to have anything. But you can go into the manufacturer's website, and you can download every one of these manuals that you want. And the manuals themselves are free, but instead of providing them with a PLC, that's where you have to go and get them now. So this came out of the manual for the actual Adam Bradley Micrologic 1000 instruction set manual. And this is the syntax for a input-output instruction. First of all, we start off with the file type. So right now we're going to start off using I for input. And then we're going to use O, not zero, the letter O to indicate output. That's what we're going to start off with. So these. Then we start off with a data file number, and we'll look at this right here. So in RSLogic 500, every type of instruction is assigned to a section of memory inside the PLC. So we start off with data file 1, data file 2, data file 3, data file 4, data file 5, right down the line. Since the inputs cannot move around, these are optional. So normally for outputs, I think outputs would be, this would get very confusing. I think outputs are data file 0. So I'd say output, then I'd say 0, and this would work. But these guys can't move around. So since they can't move around, they're always in the same place. For your input and your output, your ins and your outs, this right here is not used. But later on, when we get into timers and counters and stuff like that. One of the biggest differences with RSLogic 500 and your newer programming languages is on RSLogic 500, the application manages the memory inside the PLC. So we have different things that are in certain data files, which we'll look at in a minute. The newer PLCs, the memory is assigned as you use it. So in new PLCs, you manage the memory inside the PLC. In RSLogic 500, the application manages the memory. So what happens if you don't use any counters, then you're losing like 4,096 bytes of memory. I mean, four counters, even though you don't what? You don't use them. So this is a big difference between new PLCs, is that you manage the memory in the inside the PLC with the new applications. For RSLogic 500, and you can understand because this was back in a time when this programming language came out where electricians didn't understand memory anyway. But this has advanced a lot since then. But when I use counters and timers, so I'll start off like I want a timer. I'll start off and I'll say T4. So we have to use these on timers. But what we can do is we can have multiple data files for timers. So if I run out of space inside the T4, then I can add another space for timers. But input and output, these are there. You can't move those around. So you can't move those around. So you don't have to specify the data file numbers. Then we put a colon. Then we put a slot number. Now on a fixed PLC, your internal I/O will always be slot 0 now. But if we was to add more modules out here, then these are going to be slot numbers above that, right? Does that make sense? So slot numbers. So this right here is not required for us right now. I'm sorry, it is required. Duh. But for ours, we're going to put slot 0. So we'll start off. For an input. We'll say N. Then we'll put colon. We don't have to put a data file number because these are inside the PLC, so we'll put a colon. Then we'll come up here and we'll put a slot number. So our slot numbers are going to be 0 because we're not going to use any modules on this PLC, so all of them inside. Then what we do, then what's required is, this is not required, if we put a dot, and we'll run into these in timers, then we would specify a word. Now input output, this only applies to modules that has multiple words. Now what's a word?
Was
it 16? 16 bits, yeah. 16 consecutive bits, but you asked it like a question, yeah. So 16 consecutive bits is a word. So Allen Bradley PLCs, even the new one, even the Contact Logics, the new PLCs, they deal with words. So if I was to buy a 32-bit module and it was in slot 1, then I would start up for the first 16 inputs. That would be input, input, then we'd say 1, and then this, then we'd put a slash, and this number right here would be could be anywhere from 0 to 15. If I moved over to the second one, we would come up and we would say, it would still be in slot 1, right? Then I'd put a what? I'd put a dot, and then I would put a 1, so I messed the top one up. And this is one of the questions. Over here, I'd put slot one, 0, and then I'd put a slash, and it'd be 0 through 15 to specify which bit. But then I would go 1.1, then I'd put slash 0, and then I would go 0 to 15. Now, this would be in one module, but this would be a 32-bit input module because it occupies two words. So since we don't have any 32-bit input modules, then we don't need to put that. So that's optional. So if you don't put it, it's understood to be word 0. And then we'll put a slash, and then we'll put a bit number within that word. So that is required for inputs, outputs. So ours will start off right now. We'll say I for input. And our slot number is going to be what?
Zero.
Because it is not a slot. These are internal. Then I'm not going to put a dot because we don't have multiple word input modules. Then I'm going to put a slash. And then I'm going to come up here. I'm going to put a required bit number. That makes sense? So if I come over here and look at this PLC right here. Let me bring up my camera. So they're numbered, so this is 0. So if I wanted to address this switch right here, I would start off I:0/0. Make sense? If I wanted to address this one, this would be 0/1, this would be 0/2, 3. Now we're going to have a little problem. Then this would be 4, 5, 6, this would be 7. And that's all we have wired up. But notice this one's set up for the Siemens PLC and then it starts repeating. So right now don't pay any attention to these. Now if I was on the, if you're on the other trainer, these are your outputs. So this would be output 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And we're going to use these lights to simulate that. This would be input 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now these are nothing but normally open push buttons. This would be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So this guy right here's got, I counted wrong. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So this guy's got 9 inputs. If I wanted to address this selector switch right here, this would be input I:0/0123456. And then you'd address this guy. That makes sense?
Right, move your hand so it's okay. Say that again, I'm sorry.
If I wanted to address this one,
So if I wanted to address this one, this would be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now these are actually have the numbers on top of them. They're pretty easy to see. Over here though, these are, these selector switches are not numbered. So this would be input 0. This would be 1, 2, 3, 4. This would be 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So we'll never use 9.
But you don't count the last one?
I did.
The 10th one?
There's not 10 on there? Yeah, but they start with 0.
Oh, I understand.
Yeah, y'all, one thing you got to get used to in computers, number 0 is an address. So the analogy I use is like when the kicker runs out on the field of a football game, he's got the number 0. It don't mean it exists. That's his number. That's his address, right? You understand that? So that's one thing you got to get learning. These computers, addresses start with 0. These are not numbers. These are addresses.
I understand the first part, the slot, but what I'm not following is the bit.
Well, what we have to do is that this is only one, this right here is only one input, so that is a bit. So what we have is we have a bit. So what happens is when we load these things in, so let me just escape this and discard this. And let me go back up to where we was somewhere. I think I got a blank one up here somewhere. Doesn't make any difference. So what we do is we got what we call a input data file. So my inputs. So up here I've got inputs on the RS Logic 1000. I got input 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Now out here on input 0, we've got a normally open push button. And then it's coming up here. And then on 1, coming into 1, I've got another normally open push button. And 2, I have another normally open input. And here I have another normally open input. And then I have another normally open input. And I'm not going to go any further. So what I wanted to do, and then we're using syncing inputs. We've already talked about that. So it means all these inputs over here, and I should have drawn these, all these inputs are connected to plus 5 volts. Now I want to add, and this is 0, and I want to address, I want to bring it to my PLC. So I come on my PLC, and I come over here and I draw that guy right there. And I want this input to go true when this first push button right here is pressed. So what I do is I address it. I say, okay, I'm going to tell my PLC to look at input colon 0/0. So now, if I press that button, that guy right there closes. If I don't press that button, that guy right there opens. That makes sense now?
Yeah.
So what we're doing, and if I wanted this to control output, so my outputs are on the other side. And we're using sourcing outputs. So my outputs are connected here. Now all we have right here is lights. So this is the light that's address 0. Well, if I wanted that light to come on, So it's over here, it's connected to output 0. And this comes into the PLC. Then what I would do is I'd come over here, right? And I'd say out, and I wanted this light to come on when I press that button. I'd put colon, I'd put 0/0. If I wanted another one to come on, I would put 0/1, 0/2. So what we're doing is we're actually addressing, telling the PLC which one of those switches to come in here and actually look at, or which output to make true. That makes sense now? So what you're doing, you're actually specifying a physical address of where each one of these bits are located. So these are bits, because they can only be one state. They can be what? They can be on or off. So these are bit instructions. So that's a good question. Any more? Everybody got that? So what you're doing in your program, when you set that address up, you're saying, okay, go out there and look at that and see if that switch is what, closed or open. And actually, you're looking at a what we call an input data file, which I'll show y'all in a minute. So this guy right here, if I was to put this program right here, input slot 0, this is your internal address 0. So that would be, on yours, that would be, if you're on one of the 1000s, that would be looking at, and this is a bad instruction right here, by the way, and we'll talk about this, well, it may or may not be. And this is where you're going to get into differences between relay logic and PLC logic. This would look at switch 1. This right here would look at bit 2. This would energize output 0. This would energize output 1. If you're using outputs, but we'll talk about that too. In RSH at 500, a symbol is an optional logical text address assigned to an input or output instruction's physical address. Once a symbol has been assigned, the symbol name can be used instead of the physical address if the same device, usually a contact, needs to be used in multiple rungs or lines. Symbols are displayed on a green background. In your PLC applications, these are referred to as tags, and these are required. For this reason, just to get you used to using tags or symbols, we're going to make you assign tags, I mean symbols, to your instructions. And I showed you how to do that, right? So what we do to start a new PLC program, first of all, we need to establish communication with the PLC, if not already accomplished. The book doesn't cover that. Then we're going to start a new program. Most of your PLCs call this a project. Select the module of the CPU being the program. If you got additional I/O, then what you have to do is you have to tell your application what I/O you have. And I'll show you all that in a minute. Normally, we don't have additional I/O, so this is one step in this class we can skip over, but you need to know this. So if it's on a test, this would be the procedure, right? And then you can start your program. One thing the book doesn't actually cock, and I just realized this when I was looking over this, it doesn't tell you how to download it to the PLC. So I'm going to come up here, so on your computer, you should have an interface cable on the side. So the ArchLogic 1100s are using Ethernet IP, and then the MicroLogic 1000 are using the DH485 over an RS-232 interface. And I think I showed y'all basically how you would. These are all set up. So once you connect your interface cable to your PLC, so let me go ahead and connect mine. So after the computer boots, on the bottom, on the taskbar, you should have a little ladder there. This is where the application, the ArchLogic 500 application. We can click on that. This should bring ArchLogic 500 up. I'm going to bring mine full screen. Mine was up already, so everybody see the little icon on the taskbar?
Yeah.
It's a little ladder. If it's not on the taskbar, then you would come into all your programs over here. And then, of course, on
Windows 10, it would pop up the same, and then you would come back and you would find the RS Logic's software, and then the actual application should be in there. So I've got 500 and 5,000 installed on mine, but right now all you have on your computer is RS Logic 500 English version. And you just click on that, and it should load up. But what we've done is we go ahead and put that on the taskbar for it, which makes it easier this semester. Then we'll come up here on your bar at the top. You come up here and just tap on comms, and then go to system comms, and this should show you if you're connected to your PLC or not. If it comes up. So I'm using the RS-232 or DH-485. Zero is my computer, and one, this is my Micrologic 1100 PLC. If you are using Ethernet IP, then your PLC should be under this right here. So I'm going to come up here and just make sure this PLC is selected. Right now, this PLC does not have a name. I'll show y'all later on. And it would be nice to give each PLC a different name, especially if you had them networked, right? You understand? And you don't know which PLC, and they're all the same PLC. And you don't know, you might have a process section and a sorting section or stuff like that. It would be nice to know what PLC that is. So if you click on OK, then we're ready to program. So setting up the PLC or the communication channel is a lot harder, but once it's set up, it should be pretty simple. Now once we're up here, then what we can come into. We'll go over here up on the ribbon below the main ribbon. We should have a little folder, a little icon on the all the way on the left. And notice if you hover on it, it comes up and says new. So we'll come up here and click on new. And the first thing it asks you, since this guy right here has a lot of different PLCs that it programs. And you're going to have to tell it which one of these PLCs you have. And this is the CPU. So luckily ours are right down here together. So if you look on the right hand side, and we did this last class, there should be a label on there that tells you which PLC you have or which CPU you have, and also it should tell you which model you have. So if you look on this one on the right hand side, this is a 1100, then it says Series B on there. So that means if you're on one of these, then what you'll do is you'll drop down to, yes?
Are we on the Linux gateways or the AB underscore?
width and the same length, I'm gonna be existing, number 11 was in there.
Number 11, somebody got number 11. You're gonna have to use the same PLC all the time now. You're gonna have to use the same computer all the time, and it doesn't tell you why.
Can you repeat that?
So on your front of your PLC, there is a number on there. And you need to use, why am I requiring that?
Because it has that address on it.
Well, when you save your program, it's gonna be saved on this computer. Then you come back next class, and you get another computer, and you're working on a program, what's the problem? You won't have it, right? So y'all understand that. So we got a couple of here, I'll have to come back and look at.
Just to make sure, the MicroLogic 1000 is 1761, MicroLogic 1000?
Yes, I'm sorry, I should've showed you that. Good point. So there's only one MicroLogic, what's nice about that, there's only one of them on there.
Well, there's...
There's only one MicroLogic.
There's three 1761 MicroLogic 1000, but I don't think analog and VH or more E5 is...
When you go to system comm...
It's a little ladder.
When you go to systems comm, you see more than one 1000 right here? So what we're doing is the first listing, when you go to communication comms, don't go see who's active, it's system comms, right? And then you should only have one MicroLogic there. You shouldn't have to change the PLCs on this. Oh, I know what you're talking about. You're talking about when you create a new program. When you create a new program, there's only one MicroLogic 1000 on here that I know of.
And
so here's MicroLogic 1000, 1761, there's only one of those in the list, so that's, which is nice. The 1100, we have two in the list. We have I'm sorry, I see what you're talking about now. No, it's not this one, it's
I'm
not this.
Clarifying.
Yeah, it's the one, it's the MicroLogic 1000.
I got the third one.
So how about the one on the top, I have B and C, B and A, just, there, 1763.
Yeah, but what we're looking at is the series. So if you look at the label on the side, I see series, and mine has a B under it.
Okay, I see it.
Yeah. So all the 1100s we have are series Bs. And all the 1000s we have are not analog. They're not a DH485 over a. It's not a master-slave type situation. So all the 1000s we have are just this 1000 right here. So good point. I didn't know those other two was in there. Okay, any more? If you can't connect, then we'll just have to look at it.
Another question. So when you go to comms, what do you call that? Go to comms, system comms. I'm supposed to see MicroLogic 1000 on that?
Yeah, right under this right here.
I don't know why it's not.
Just extend that one to see it.
Oh, extend it?
Yes, not that area, yeah.
I don't see it. I extended it. It's just, I'm plugged up.
I don't have my glasses, I can't hear. Yeah, you're good.
I'm on, but it's not.
Okay, that's okay. Y'all just need to let me know.
It's not like you got on your screen there.
So does it show the actual workstation?
I got workstation, links, gateway, Ethernet.
No, you don't want the Ethernet IP. You're on one of the 1000s, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So you're looking under the DFI, DH485 is where it should be at.
Okay, I see what you're saying. I got you.
Yeah, so right now,
it's got a big text on mine.
Yeah, so that means it's not finding it for some reason.
Mine connected now after a minute. Oh, never mind.
Yeah,
we're
right underneath there. It's the same thing as big old
there. We can play around with this from here. By the way, you can create programs without having the PLC connected up. But you can do what we call offline programs. So right now, my application is offline. So this is very important to know. We got three, when I go to offline, I got three things. I can go online, I can download, or I can upload.
Go online doesn't mean on?
Huh?
Go online doesn't mean on?
No.
Go online doesn't mean wrong?
No.
Okay.
Online means you're connected to the PLC and you can download programs or you can upload programs.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that you're telling it to run. Now ours, we have three modes that we can operate the PLC in. And we talked about this last class. So the three modes we can operate the PLC in is we can operate it in program mode. If you got it in program mode, then that means you are capable of uploading and downloading programs. If you got it in run mode, if you tell it to go into the run mode, then the PLC runs the program. If you go into online mode, then you can monitor the program while it's running. Okay, that's the three modes. Now, normally, on most of your PLCs, the PLC can be in three modes. The PLC can be in what we call, my camera's not working, dang it. Oh, it's on the other camera. So most of your PLCs will have a key switch on it. And if it focuses, let me bring it up full screen. I've got three modes I can put it in. I can put it in run, I can put it in remote, and I can put it in program. To upload or download a program, we would have to switch it into the what? Program mode. To cause it to run the program, I put it in the run mode. Then this other mode right here is we have what we call the remote mode. Remote mode means you switch the PLC through the different modes with the application itself. So right now we have ours in, and this is the key. This is key. So right now it's set up by default. It's called remote. What's nice about the key PLC is if I switch it over to run, then nobody can connect to it with a computer and change anything in there if you don't have the key. If you got it in remote mode, anybody that's got the application on their computer can connect to the PLC and change the program.
It's connected with the internet?
Huh?
Connected with the internet? No?
Not necessarily the internet.
Okay.
There's a lot of companies that run, that network their PLCs, but they don't put them on the internet for obvious reasons. But so I can go into my office and I can connect to my PLCs, but somebody else outside in Chicago can't do that. Now, some people do leave it up to them, but some companies don't. But in the remote mode, it means that right now, so on RS-232, so right now the MicroLogic 1000 is used in Ethernet IP. Which means I can connect this to, I can connect it to internal routers, I can connect it to switches, which means I can access this anywhere. The 1100s, we're using RS-232 DH-485. This is a peer-to-peer. You cannot connect to that any other way, except with a computer connected to the PLC. And this is one reason why the Ethernet IP, even though it's not as efficient as the 485, is becoming the predominant standard for networking PLCs because everything's out there is readily available. So no, it's up to the company whether they want to bring in a virtual VPN or a virtual private network and allow people into their PLC network. Some people actually turn it on and turn it off just to let people in for special applications. We had a guy worked at, I don't know if it was Brothers, but one of our companies. He said some person was actually changing the programs on their PLC while they were actually working on it. So you got to be really careful on who you give access and when you give them access if you do that. We could do this with the MicroLogic 1000s, but the driver that we're using for the with 1100s, the driver that we're using for the 1000s does not allow that at all. You actually have to connect to the PLC. But if we got it in remote mode, which all our PLCs in here are in remote mode, it means we can switch the PLC between program and run remotely with the application. The MicroLogic 1000s, that's the only option you got. With 1100s, inside your menu, there's one option where you can switch it between program run and then remote. But still, it's not protected with a key. The only problem that I've seen is every PLC that I've seen, this key is the same for every PLC. So if you let the keys get out when you buy them, then that means you have different people out there, so you need to control those keys. But the PLC itself's only got, it's got either two modes, either what, run and program, or it's got three modes. Whichever one I've seen's got these three modes, which is run, remote, program. But when you got it in the remote mode, what does that mean? Well, that means we can do what? We can change in between modes with our PLC. I mean, not with our PLC, with our... So that means, and what I'm saying, guys, if you got a PLC at home that's got this application on it, you bring it up, you select the CPU, you configure the I.O., you can write your program, and then you can come back on work on Monday and download it into it. So you don't have to be connected to a PLC to write the program for the PLC. But you got to select the right CPU. That makes sense? Yeah. So there's a lot of programs that's written at home, and then they'll come in and download them into PLC when they come back to work. So which PLC do I have selected?
Mr. Adam, these, mine's blinking false red light.
Yeah, don't worry about that right now. I appreciate that, but right now we're just kind of... So it looks like I chose the 1000 this time. So one thing you'll notice right off the bat, if I choose the MicroLogic 1000, since it's a fixed PLC, so what this is over on the left-hand side, this is the project tree, and this shows you your data files. So S0, S1, ladder 2, ladder 3, ladder 4, ladder 5, ladder 6, ladder 7, ladder 8, ladder 9. If you're on the 1000s, you're not, 1100s, you're not going to see that. So the number of ladder diagrams you can make inside the 1100s is you can have 14 data files. And that's it. But on the 1100, I'll show you how you can create data files when you start running out of it. So here's the actual data files we were talking about. So output is data file 0, inputs are data file 1. Status, we will be using that. No, we won't use that. B3, we're going to be using B3, T4s, T5s, and this is how far we'll get. Each one of these have 256 elements or storage locations available to us. If you're on the 1000, you can't create any more. If you're on the 1100, you can create more integers, you can create more counters, you can create more control. So like I said, fixed PLCs, you get what you pay for. The 1100, though, is an expandable PLC, so it means we can add different things. So if we had a port, if we had an input port over here, then this is where we would come in and actually tell it right here on IO configuration over the project tree. This is where we would come up and tell it what additional modules we have added to this PLC. So the 1000, you won't have anything there, but here we can come up and we can add oh, I got the 1000 selected. Duh. Let me go back in. No. So on the 1000, you can't do anything there, but let me bring up the 1100 again, which has the ability to. So we got a Series B. Now when I go to IO, these are the different modules we could buy for this PLC. So right now we're not going to have to do this because we don't have any additional modules strapped on to the right hand side. If we did, we would have to know the model number and everything of the modules that we have attached. This makes sense so far? Okay. You can't see this?
I'll catch up with you.
So on the 1100s, you've got one guy out there. You can't add modules to the 1000, excuse me. To the 1000s, you can't add modules to the 1000. To the 1100, you can add modules to it. So if you click on this on the 1000, it'll show you one thing out there, and you can't add. So you don't get this exact type display if you're on the 1000s. And once we've got all that configured, then we are ready to do our program. Now the application knows what CPU you got, so that tells it what instructions are going to be available and how to compile them over. And it also tells the application if you have any additional IO modules out there. This is our user menu. These are the menus. And right now we won't show you how to add and subtract to this because the new application is a little. This is pretty complicated. But this is the most often used instructions. So this is what you have to do. You can't put anything in rung zero. You can't put anything in the end rung because this is the end of the program. So what we need to do is we need to come in and we need to insert rungs. So this right here, this is the symbol for a rung, and you got to get used to dragging. Everybody knows how to drag, right? So what do? You left click your mouse and pull it down, and then the X will turn green, and then you can come in and you can insert a rung. Everybody okay? Even if you're not connected to the PLC, you should still be able to connect this. I'm going to bring in a normally open contact or examinative close. Right now we got an error. One little feature that I don't like about RSLogic 500 is once you've got the error, it's going to stay there until you check it. Most of your newer PLC languages, as soon as you clear it, it'll clear it for you. But that's what the E on the side means. We got an error. Are we okay? Then what we'll do is I'm going to come up here and just double click on the question mark and it's looking for either a symbol name or an address. Well, we hadn't done symbols yet, so we'll assign it an address. So I'm going to say I, then we'll put colon 0/0. So what we did is we just told this program to look at that switch 0 on the trainer. And then I'm going to hit enter. Now at the top, this is where you're going to enter a comment if you want to. It's up to you if you want to use them. But what we're gonna do is either click on the symbol name down here or just hit tab and it'll move down to there. And we're gonna give this a name. Now luckily, on your programs this semester, they're gonna give you the diagram or they're gonna give you the names that you'll use. So they'll say push button one needs to be closed, the green light will turn on or stuff like that. Of course, we don't have green lights on our trainers. You'll just assign it to one of the lights on your trainer.
Mr. Raymond, what did you drag down?
I dragged down, okay, right here. I can zoom in on the diagram itself, but I can't zoom in on the symbols. So you have the first one. This is a rung. This is a rung branch. And right beside that is your, if I hover above that, it says it's examined if closed. And we'll have to really understand what that means. But this is a normally open push button.
When you tag it, if it's push button, it's the first push button. Would you call it push button one?
Well, you'll call it whatever you want to call it. So it might be start, it might be stop, it might be turn on motor one, it might be turn on motor two. It's what normally we try to give it a name on what it does in the application itself.
But you know how the terms kind of change in the world. Do they ever call it push button zero to coordinate?
Well, they could if that's what they called it in your plan. So normally when you look at these push buttons, they'll have a label on them. And then what you want to do is you want to probably give it the same name as the label that's on the push button.
So they do use that terminology, push button zero instead of push button one?
Yeah, you can call it anything. You can call it Sam. You can call it Fred. You can call it, these symbols are up to you, but you don't want to. I think I told you about our electrical instructor that would call his programs ping pong. So what did we have to do? We had to open them up and see what they did because he didn't give the thing's name on what they did. So yeah, it's up to your company, the syntax you use for symbols. You can literally give them anything you want to, except some symbols are not allowed. So you can't use dashes. Anything that you can't put in a file name, you can't put in the symbol. Underscores are fine. So I got out of sync. So I assigned it an address, but I didn't assign it a symbol, right? I skipped over that. So what can I do? Well, I'm gonna come here and right click on it. And then it's going to say, then if I don't do that, then it's going to give me the ability to edit the symbol. So I could call it play if I want to. This is up to your company, right? But I need to give it a name that basically goes with the system that it's running. But what's nice about this class, they're going to tell you the names. So they'll say, push button zero, push button one, green lamp. Now it says, we don't have any green lights on our trainer. All we got lights, but we're gonna hook it up. We're gonna say output zero, but we'll call it green lamp or whatever that because that's what the program is. But that's a really good question. What you need to do is you need to give these things a name, so you can come back next year and know what ping pong means, right?
Maybe the name has to do more with the output. Like you call the input red light.
Well, but yeah, but this is. I mean, if this is push button zero. Then I can come up and I could call it PB0 if I wanted to. But what you're trying to do is you're trying to label it what it's labeled out on the system, right? You understand? Or some abbreviation of the system. You know, a lot of times you don't want your symbols to get extremely large, but you want to make it so I can go out there and look at that push button and know what push button we're talking about in my program. But see, I can use this push button multiple times, so I can come up here and I can insert a rung, and now I've given it a name. So what I can do, I can pull this guy here, I can pull this down, and then now I can say PB0, and it automatically inserts the address for me. So that's what's nice about symbols, is that if we use the same device multiple times, and we do this with inputs all the time, you know, I could have I wish I had over in motor controls. We usually teach this in motor controls. And I have a switch out there that's got 8 contacts that it controls. So they're stacked up there. PLCs, we don't have to do that. We can have one switch that's normally open And then we can assign as many contact numbers to that as we want. And they don't have to be normally open, normally closed. It's up to you. Or examine if open, examine if closed. It's up to you which one you do.
So you can use normally closed and normally open instead of like the push button symbol we normally see where it's the two circles in the line.
What do you mean? The name?
Wait, what?
I'm not sure about your question.
So usually when I see push buttons, it's got the two circles and then the line through it, you know, it's like normally open.
Two circles?
Yeah.
I'd have to see the symbol.
The symbol is a push button, you're saying, is yeah, like it's the line with the line going up. It's got two circles.
Oh, that is the electrical symbol of a push button.
Okay.
These are program symbols for an input. What could be on that input? This could be a temperature sensor. This could be a pressure sensor. This could be anything. When you make your connections to the PLC, you use the symbol for the device. Inside the PLC program, you got two symbols for contact. You got either normally open or normally closed. Understand what I'm saying?
Yep, I got it.
So yeah, I mean, I could come over here, and I might have, in real life, on the mechanical side. Oh, wrong thing, Rich. So you're talking about the electrical symbol. You're not talking about the program.
Yeah.
What I'm programming. You're talking about the actual electrical symbol for the device itself. So the electrical symbol for a normally open contact would be the two circles with a bar like that. So if I was going to connect this to my PLC, and then I'm going to come over here and I'm going to hook this up to input 0, then I would draw the symbol because these are devices. These are not programs. These are devices. But then I could come down right next below it, and then I could put this, and then I could put a dashed line. The dashed line means they're controlled by the same operator. Okay. Then I might come down here and put another normally open. But this is going to be stupid because what I can do is I can use this symbol in my program. So in my program, I'd use that symbol. Down below that, I'd use that symbol. Down below this, I would use this symbol. So what's nice about the program, you can have one push button, but you can have it controlled. Technically, it's not true, but basically an infinite number of contacts. But how many contacts are actually on the physical push button itself? Woman. But in real life, that's what I said. So we have a push button up there. And then it's got the operator. And then down here, it's got all these stacks down here. And then there's a rod that runs down through here. And this right here, I think is a normally open. Then there's a normally closed. But this is on the electrical world. This is on the relay world, right? On a PLC, I hook up a switch to an input. And then in my program, I can make it do what I want it to do. So that's a really good question. So this is the symbol you was talking about. So, but that input one, you know, if I was going to connect it, that input, if it was a limit switch, then when I make my diagram for the connection, I would have to use the symbol for a limit switch on the electrical side. Inside the program, I would just call it a normally open contact. So I could have flow switches out here. You know, I could have flow switches, I could have pressure switches, I could have float switches. But inside my PLC, if they're normally open, every one of them would be represented by that right there. So electrical symbols. So when you draw your electrical diagrams, and you're going to have to do that, you're going to draw the electrical symbols. That's what the electricians hook up, right? You understand that? Inside the PLC, though, a normally open, whether it's a what, whether it's a pressure switch, whether it's a limit switch, whether it's a temperature switch, anything like that, we're going to use these two symbols right there. It's either normally open, it's either examined if closed, or examined if open. Are we okay?
That
yeah.
keeps it simple.
Yeah, it does. Because now, as an electrician, I used to have in motor controls, and I'll try to get over there one day and bring that switch over here. In relay logic, every contact has to have a contact. In the PLCs, we can have one input, and we can use it multiple times. So it only got either it's got a normally open or normally closed contact on it, and we can use it as many times as I need. So if this was a physical, so highlight where you want to put the rung. In fact, you don't have to put the rung down here at the bottom. You could put it anywhere you want to. So where you want to insert the rung, you just come up here and just click on the rung number. Then you come down here and you'll bring it in. And notice my new rung went in between there. If you want to delete a rung, you just highlight the whole rung and then hit the delete key on your keyboard. So out there, if we decided to delete a rung, we would have to disconnect wires and everything right here to get rid of rungs. We can edit rungs. So right now, if I insert a rung, it's going to go right here, right? And then I can come up here and I can, if I know how many rungs I want, I can go ahead and start off. It starts off as an arrow, right? By the way, we can change our symbol. So right here, this is an examinative closed. Down here, I already call this PB, let's call this PB0. And I said, oh my goodness, that needs to be an examinative open or normally closed. Well, if you right click on it, then if you move it down, it says change instruction type. I'm gonna click on that and I'm gonna change this to an examinative open. And notice the contact changed for me. So you don't have to delete it and add another one. You can come in and you can change the instruction. You can make it just about anything you want to. Okay. If I check it, I still have an error. What's missing?
The output.
Got to have at least, the outputs are required, right? So good. So this is the outputs we'll start off using. So here's the coil. We call it a coil even though it's physically not a coil. And then I can drag this down. By the way, I'm going to delete this. And if I come over here and drag the output, notice I got two options. If I put it right here, it automatically goes to the right. And some of your new applications don't do that, so you got to be careful. But this, if it pops up and moves to the right, you know it's a what? It's an output. It's got my question mark up here. What am I waiting for? I'm waiting for an address. So output. Colon, this is where we're going to run into problems because your O and your 0 are right beside each other. And then I'm going to assign it an address. I'm going to slot 0/0. Now if you hit enter, it's going to give you the option to put the symbol in there. Where it comes into default, it does not come into the symbol, it comes into the comment. So you can either tab, if you tab, it'll move down on your keyboard. Or you can click on that and then we can decide it. What are we going to call it? We can call it green lamp, you know, if I want to. It's up to you what you call it. By the way, you can use lowercase letters. It don't make any difference. Notice the symbol here will pop up in uppercase letters. But you want to give it a name that basically so you can look at the diagram and you know where that's at out on your actual manufacturing line. Right. In fact, you can actually give the ladder a name. Okay, so this is where we check to see if it's going to compile correctly. Well, that's the little computer up there that's got the check mark on it. So I'm going to click on it and notice the first one has no syntax error. It doesn't mean it's right. It just means it's in the right syntax. It was written correctly. So if I used output 0 and I meant to use output 1, then it's going to still say it's okay. So just because it clears that, it doesn't mean the program's right. It just means it's in the right syntax. This one didn't clear. What's wrong? Well, you notice it comes down here. As soon as I hit that, comes down here, this little thing came down here. And I'm going to say, it says file 2, which is what we're working in. It says operand, not enter. So operand, by the way, is the data that the instruction works with. So what am I missing? Well, I'm missing it on it. So it looks like I haven't assigned this one. I haven't assigned it an address. By the way, this guy lets you get by. So if I say I put 0/1 and enter it, I mean, it's so I'm going to cancel this and it's still okay. So I'll come up here and check it. Then it says I have no syntax errors. But here I'm going to fuss at you because now I don't know what this guy right here is supposed to do, right? So I accidentally didn't assign it a symbol. So what do I need to do? Right click, right? And go to what? Edit symbol. And the names that might not have anything to do with the address. You want to give it a name, right? Or and like I said, in this class, you're not going. If you look through your lab books, it'll say PV1, PV2, green lamb, bright lamb, and it's going to give you the actual symbols you need to use. Now all our programming is done in what mode? The offline mode, right?
Yeah.
Offline. Some of the new PLCs allow you to edit online, but that is a very dangerous thing to do. Says what when you go down to your problem?
What?
So when I come up here, it says it has to be identified to the bit level. So what it means is you didn't assign it a bit number. That makes sense? And the problem is it does not turn any color. So if I come up here and I said output 0, and then I hit enter, it went ahead and, yeah. So I said output 0, right? And I'm going to come up here and check it. And it says, I got an error. And it says, address must be specified in the bit level. Well, I told it to use output 0, but I didn't tell it what bit in output 0 to use. You understand? So these are written in technical terms, so you're going to have to learn these errors. So they take for granted that you know a lot of stuff about computers already. So it means a bit, that's one of the bits inside a 16-bit file. So what we have to do is, if we got a 16-bit output file, 0 through 15, and I have to tell it which bit to use, which one of those outputs I'm going to use on the front of that PLC. So I just come up here, just double click, and then come back here and make my correction. And it says it's already got that symbol. Now when I come up here and check it, it says I have no syntax error.
If you're not connected to your PLC, but you put a bit number in, will it still green light it or no?
If you put a bit number that's not in that PLC, so when you selected the PLC, it knew how many inputs and outputs that it had. So I can come over here on this one and I can say, okay, output colon 1/0. It didn't let me do it. Output colon 0/17. So I'm going to come up here, so I don't have a 17 on my outputs. All I've got is 0 through 5. So right off the bat, it gave me an error. So let's see what the error says. So we'll come up here and check it. And no, it didn't tell me the error. It didn't pop up at the bottom. But it knows as soon as you specify the PLC, it knows how many inputs and outputs that are available. That's a good question, too.
But if you're, let's say like, cause you know, like my, I'm not connected to my PLC right now.
But when you started the program, you selected a model number. You said you got the RS Logic 1100.
So it knows.
It knows why, it knows the 1100. And that's a good question, cause it didn't give me, it didn't give me an error, but it wouldn't work. So any more questions? So right now you're having problems connected to your PLC, but like I said, once you got it set up, you can write these, we call it offline programming. I mean, we call it, well, it's called offline. So you're actually offline. So I could come up here right now and I can disconnect my PLC. So you could literally, if you've got the application, you could literally write your program at home, right? You understand? And then I'll show y'all later on how you can force things to see if it works. You know, simulate, you can simulate inputs and you can simulate outputs. We call them forcing to check your program at home to see if your outputs come true and that kind of stuff. So that's a good question too. Any more? Okay, so we're all connected, right? Okay. So if we wanted to download this, so we check for errors, if y'all got it in there. If you don't, are we okay? And then we can go to download. So download, you send it to the PLC. Now this is where you're gonna give your program a name. This is one thing I don't like about this. All your new applications, you give your project a name when you start. With RS Logic 500, you give your program a name when you, so we'll just call this a demo. And we hit save.
All right, before you jump ahead of there, where did you find the PLC? I don't see the PLC on the.
So right here we go to this guy right here.
Right.
We say download.
Download.
And then this should pop up.
I don't even have that box at the top left.
What's that?
I don't have the box on the top left.
I don't either. Go to
where it says offline and all that. All this, yes sir, all those drop tabs, I don't have those.
You don't have those?
No sir.
I want the comms.
I need to close out the program and restart it.
Yeah, let's see if we can pick it up somewhere else. So.
You can download it.
Yeah,
you can. But it should, that thing should be there. And my application is froze up. Okay, so if you don't have it here, so normally this is where it should be at, and we won't close our application that name. But if you go to comms, you should have a download option inside comms also. Is it in there? Don't say no. So normally this is where we would do it at.
All right, so once we get to that, I can't find the PLC folder, or whatever you want to call it. And once you get the download, save in, the PLC doesn't appear anywhere.
So this right here does not pop up?
Correct.
When you say download?
Correct.
Huh.
So it wants
saying in documents.
It's fine. Wherever you, in fact, you could literally change the folder. So you could bring in a USB thumb drive if you wanted to, and you could save your programs on those. But it's going to give you a default folder. Normally it's inside documents, so the default folder here doesn't make any difference. As long as you do what? Do the same. Make sure you see where it's going to put it at. But if you want it in documents, you can come up here and go to docs. I'm saving mine. By default, I'm saving mine on our file server. So you're not going to see this. This is a folder I have set up on our file server, which is over in the other room. So that's a really good question. So I've set, and of course I've called it MicroLogic 1000 because I have programs on here for, 1100, because I have another folder called 1000 and I have a folder called 5000. Okay. So that's I understand what you're saying now.
I can save it on desktop.
You can save it on desktop if you want to. Yeah, on these computers, you're going to use the same computers all the time. So we was going to call this what? Demo? So that's a really good question. I understand the question now, yeah. So yeah, you could bring a thumb drive if you wanted to, you know, and that's your call. All I got to do is have them available to me.
Do we have to click any more buttons or anything before
you
save it after that?
No, you just hit save.
Mine says communication path is not good.
Well, what you need to do is, does it give you an option? Does it give you a yes or something like that?
It just says one button that says OK.
Then click on OK and let it take.
How about mine?
Huh?
Are you sure you would like to process with the download? Yes. Are you sure you want to process with the download?
Yeah, because it's going to give you several options. Because what's going to happen, if you've got a program in your PLC right now, and you just go ahead and it lets you download it, it's going to wipe out your old program and put your new program in there. So right now there's probably a program in there called called checkout, where when I wired it up, I put a little program in there where I could flip the switches and the outputs would come through. That's a good question.
Apply?
Yes.
Apply?
Yes. I've got a window that says controller properties.
Yes.
A couple more tabs on it.
Really?
Yes, sir.
Oh, let's see. You can't do this. So you got the same outfit. So your program probably works because it's going to have this. Yeah, we'll follow this one and this right here won't come. So you need to change it. But now it's got the same symbol. Oh, you can. I check here. Yeah, and that's the problem. If you duplicate, address.
Then we go with the last one.
This right here will go with the last one because it scanned last. And so that rung up there won't mean anything. And the problem is it don't give you an error if you duplicate addresses. And we'll show y'all why it does that because there are some situations where we can do this. How do we do? So mine's doing the same as yours. So in Dali, I got a little problem with mine. So what you should do once you get on here, it's going to give you the option of going online, right? So notice this is what remote is. So remote, what you're doing, you're switching it between those modes with your computer instead of doing it with a key on the front of the PLC. And it's up to you which way you choose. I can't find mine anymore, but that's okay. So y'all have written your first program. Or I wrote it. Symbols, starting a new PLC program. And we've had a little problem. So some of y'all didn't work because we didn't have the communication established, right? You understand? So it couldn't find the PLC. So mine's got a little problem right now. I'm not going to step through it because I can probably fix it. But there's more to it than just if you're using if you're using Ethernet IP, then the first thing you've got to do, so your PLCs are going to use what we call dynamic IPs. Dynamic IPs means you have to somehow assign it through a DHCP server. So what I had to do is I had to come up here and I had to go to RSLink. So this is still new. By the way, even in RSLogic 5000, these two applications are still used. So when we go into the RSLogic software, or Rockwell software, then what we would use, we'd use RSLink, and this is where you install in RSLink Classic, and this is where you actually install the driver that you're using. So configure driver. So like I said, these are all the drivers that this version of the PLC supports. So we're using either RF 232 DFI, which is a EH485 interface, or we're using Ethernet. Now, if you're using Ethernet, then what that means is now you have to assign the PLC a IP address. Now, the problem is that you can't assign it an IP address. All we did with RSLink is just establish the driver. Well, what we'll do here, what we'd have to do now, is I would have to come back in this same software, and then I would have to run the Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol, or DHCP. I would have to run the DHCP tool. And then you have to select which network card you're using. So we have a lot of PLC or computers that have multiple ways it can communicate. And then what I have to do is I have to know the MAC address. So what's happening is now the DHCP server is looking for a device to ask for an IP address. And what you have to know is you have to know the media access control, or the MAC address of the device. Now, where is this sitting? On your new PLCs, it's probably going to be written on the front somewhere. So this is a... or somewhere. So right here on this PLC, I'm going to come up here and I'm going to bring up my camera. And hopefully it's going to. So this little label right here, and it's given to you in hexadecimal. It's a 48-bit number, 00000BCE566A6. Well, what I would do is I would wait for that to pop up in my DHCP server. And then what I would do, then I would assign it an IP address. And those IP addresses, basically, I think, I don't know if we talked about it in this class, but the IP address consists of two parts. It consists of what we call a subnet. So we can have a network that's split up in different subnets. One network for sure is the internet. Well, what we do is, and so the IP address like this one is 192.254.58. And then we substitute that. Well, what this is what we call Class C network. And this only comes into play on private networks. So what we would do is this would be 255.255.255.0. Well, the subnet mask, what it does, it identifies what portion of the IP address is the subnet address. So that has a match. Every PC on this network has that 192.254.58. If you change that to 57, you wouldn't be able to find it. They're on the same subnet. And this is where binary comes into play. So what you would do is you would come in here and you would split this into binary. So the ones, 1, 2, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4. The ones identifies the subnet, and then the zeros identify the node or the computer on the network. So if you don't know how to go between binary, you cannot make subnet maps. Most of your subnet maps, so used to we had class A. Class A used a subnet mask of 255.0.0.0. Class B used a subnet mask of 255.255.0.0. And class C used a subnet mask of 255.255.255.0. So class C, we could have 256 nodes or computers. Class B, we could have 16,384. And class A, we could have, I could figure that out. We could have a lot. What we're doing now is what we call a classless subnet. So classless subnet means you figure out your subnet mask. You start putting ones for your subnet. And then from then on, you put zeros. So if you don't know how to go between binary, because you enter your subnet mask in decimal, but the subnet mask itself is binary. So now we use what we call classless, and you'll have to go between the two bases.
Where are you turning this binary?
Huh?
Where are you turning the binary?
The subnet mask. So the subnet mask, you enter it in as 255.255.255.0. Now this is okay for what we call the classful subnet mask. But unfortunately now, because it wastes so many IPs, you know, if I use a class B, so if I needed 257, if I needed 257 computers on my network, I would have to go to a class B. Well, a class B allows me to use 16,384. So I basically wasted a ton of IPs. So what we use now is what we call a classless IP, which means you make up your subnet mask. I mean, you can put ones anywhere, but the subnet starts with the most significant bit and moves toward the least significant bit, and then the node ID moves from the least of it toward the most. Zeros identifies the number of nodes you can have. And then, so if I had 5 computers on my network, then I could use a subnet mask of 255.255.250, and that would be my subnet mask. But 250, you'd have to understand that in binary. So what we're trying to say is that whatever IP, so you'd come up here, first of all, you need to figure out where your computer's at. By the way, 192.254, these are what we call private IPs, which means these IPs are not legal on the internet. If one of them got on the internet, it just wouldn't go anywhere. So we call these private IPs. So this is what you use inside your business. And then it goes through something called a gateway. You know, gateway converts protocols. So a gateway would take your private IP and convert it over to an internet IP. So what this does, so we have different things going on now, guys. But the problem is what I'm saying, if you can't go between bases, then you cannot even configure, you don't know. So you come up and you just make up an IP address, you can't do that. You have to know the IP that your computer's using. So you got two options on your IP addresses. So let's go to in control panel. Control panel is not in the menu for Windows 10, but what you probably need to do is just type in control panel and add it to your main menu. And what we're going to do is we're going to go to network. in there somewhere. Network sharing configuration. And then I'm gonna go to my adapter settings. And then I'm gonna find all the different things that uses IPs. Here's my local ad, this is my network card. And then private IPs, we use IPv4. So right now I have this set up to, I have this one set up to use static IPs. If you select dynamic IPs, what that means is it's gonna go out and look for a DHCP server and let somebody assign it for you. If you go to static IPs, it means the IP never moves. This makes sense? It's a lot to it. So what we're saying is that, you know, and we teach more of this in PLC 2 when we actually teach all the communication standards. Right now, so there's more to it than just doing what? Then going up there and connecting a PLC up to a computer. There's more to it. Most of your PLCs now use Ethernet IP. And why? Because it's a standard that's been around for a long time. We can go out and buy regular switches, we can buy routers, everything that's out there on the market now we can use in our industrial applications. Normally we don't because they're industrial, so normally we buy heavy duty routers. It's like some of y'all have these green cords out there. Those were actually furnished by, we made these. Yeah, we make these. And you have to know how to wire these. These industrial ones, they're okay, but if you had to go 1,000 feet, you know, you're not gonna go out and buy a 1,000 foot cable, you're gonna do what? In industry, odds are you're gonna make your own cables. Because you can buy predefined links, and already to spend a lot of money, or you can make them the length that's required. So in PLC 2, we teach y'all how to make these. By the way, PLC 2 is going to be canceled. If you're in IoT 212, we're going to have to cancel that. Nobody else got into class.
How many did you need to have it accepted in your house?
We needed 10. How many did we have?
Three, and then
I
went up to four. I never did sign up for
it. Well, if we'd have got that many, if we'd have got around 7, since I'm a full-time instructor and I'm over the department, they would have probably let me teach it, but they're not going to let me teach it with 4. Because it would be an overload, so that means they would have to pay me a lot of money to teach it. So, a lot of money. Of course, I make enough, so I don't want the extra load. But I would have done it if we'd have had a bunch of others. Nobody else signed up for it, guys. So if you're in there, we need to get you out of that class. I think I've told 2 people, so there's only 2 people. Is anybody in here in IELT 212? We got to figure out something to put you in. We have fluid power. If you haven't had fluid power, that's a really good course, and we're doing the AUT 199 class, which is a certification course where you can go take that and get at least 4 certifications. You can get more, but to get an A, you got to get 4 certifications, which is a really good class to take. It's coming up in T2. I think it's a night class. But yeah, we're going to have to cancel that. We left it on the schedule because it was a T2, and we left it on the schedule because usually we have a lot of people out of this class take it. But we got to make a decision because y'all needed enough time to get in there, right? So this is an example of actually one of the programs that's running the Festo line. And you can see they use a lot of comments. The comments are good. Comments are something that if you knew it was going to take you a long time, you know, if you come back in here next year and you want to write this, comments, you can put anything in there you want to. So basically you'd probably try to put why you put that instruction inside the program. What does it do? Then they have assigned them names, so of course EM stop. What do you think that button is?
Emergency
stop. So when we're saying what you need to do is give these things names, right? Cycle in, switch three, switch two. So if you looked at the actual schematic, that they're labeled switch one, switch two, switch three. So now we can go in and look at our diagrams and see exactly where that push button is. P-Edge, we're not going to get into these instructions. We'll get into the one-shot rising and stuff like that if you take the PLC 2 class. So as far as we're going to go in here, but what I'm going to show you, and by the way, we actually stripped this down. These programs were written in Germany. So your comments not only had everything was written in English, it was also written in what? German. But we deleted those portions out of this because they were really, really big. Start flag. The F flag is set if the internal position of the start button or the start button is pressed. The F start flag is reset if switch it position manual. So what this is doing is explaining the key on the front where you can single step it or you can go to manual mode. So now I come in, I look at this, and I can actually see exactly what each one of these instructions do. So we're not requiring comments, and you can give the whole program, the whole ladder, a comment, or you can give each individual instruction a comment. So everybody okay on the three modes that the PLC can be in? The 1000s, guys, you got one mode on the 1000s. You got program and you've got run. You got two modes. And you got you got on your application, you got two modes, right? You got offline, right? Online. Your PLC can be in the remote, can be in the run or the program. The 1000s, the only option you got is remote. On the 1100s, there's a switch on the front. If you go to escape and you go down, one of them says mode switch. This could get you in trouble because if you switch it to run, then you're not going to be able to do what? You're not going to be able to download your program, right? So we want to leave in this class. We would leave it in this remote. We would leave it in the remote option. Offline, program ladder logic, offline mode where the PLC ladder logic diagram can be created and modified. So we have offline. This is your programming application. And where do we switch this at? If you got it available. Yeah. So I'll have to figure out why y'all didn't show it. We'll figure that. Offline. Then online. Download. Upload. Do y'all know the difference between download and upload?
Download to it. Upload.
Back, yeah. And why? That gives people that use the internet problems, right? Because it's what? It's opposite. It's opposite. And what's the three modes or PLC that's usually available on most PLCs for the PLC itself?
Program,
remote,
and run.
And run, right? Program to download or upload programs. Remote allows you to switch it with your computer, your application. And then run is when it actually runs the program. So, procedure, if you plan to download the program to the PLC, establish communication with the PLC, note. And like I said, we had a few problems in here. I think everybody's connected now, though, right? Place the RSLogic 500 in the offline mode, create the new program, select the correct CPU for the PLC being programmed. I need to add that. here we would make sure we configure IO, additional IO if available, right? We looked at this, we really need to understand this. And this gives people in motor controls a big problem. So normally, if I was going to do a basic, we call it a start-stop station. And this is probably the most widely used circuit out there. It allows us to start something and stop something and start something with push buttons. Is I would come over here and I would use a normally closed push button. Then we'd come over here and we'd use a normally open push button. And right now we'll just call this stop and we'll call this start. And then I'm gonna put a contact right here. And a relay coil. And we'll just call this, right now we'll just call it CR, and then I'll label this thing CR. So what this does, it allows us to start things and stop things with push buttons. And in machinery, you want everything, almost everything, to be very almost the same, right? So we don't want to go over here and start something with a switch or start something with a switch. We would like to use this little technique right here. So what happens right now, my signal flow would come up here, it would be here, and it would be here. And what's it waiting on? What's it waiting on? The start button, right? So I press the start button, but it's a momentary contact push button, so as soon as I hit it, what's that going to do? It's going to come down here and it's going to close. It's going to allow my signal to flow through. It's come over here. It's going to energize my relay. It's going to close this contact right here. And now I can do what? I can come over here and I can release this start button. And now it's sealed in. Some people call it a memory circuit. Some people call it start-stop. Some people call it sealed-in circuit. People give it a... So this thing is sealed in. Now, stop button, we want a stop button to always be a normally closed push button. Why? Of course, here it's got to be. But inside PLCs, I could come up here and I could do this same thing. And let's say I came over here and I did this, if I was writing this program, and then I came over here and did this, and then I come over here and assign this to, right now let's assign it to an output. I assign this to input 0/0. I assign this to input 0/1. Put a down drop. And I'll call this stop. I'll call this start. And let's call this run. Then out here, I'll just type in run. And as soon as I type in that symbol, it will insert the address for me. Now, on motor controls, I use a normally closed push button. So in PLCs, this gets us into big problems because this is not a push button, it's an instruction. So what I did is I took that top ladder logic for electrical, and I converted it directly into a PLC program. Now, why do we want a stop button to be a normally closed contact?
Put it in
on a PLC. Why do we need it? Up here we have no problem. Up on the top one, if a wire opens, it's going to kill it anyway. We're not looking at a wire. We're looking at a program. So what happens? What happens? If I come over here in my PLC program, this is an this is an examine if open. This is an examine if close. So to make this thing work, I'm saying, okay, it's true when it's open. I want this thing to be true to start off with. So on my PLC, when I wired this thing up, I would have to use one of these guys right here. And this would go to the input on my PLC. And then my other one, I want it to be true when it's closed. So I would use this right here. So this one I want to start out true because I want the signal to flow through it. So this right here is this right here says I want it to be true when it's open. So this is open. So it'll be true. So this allows the signal to flow through because it's true when it's open, right? You understand that? And then we're coming over, we're sitting right here. And then over here, I'm using an examine if close. So this is true when it's open. This is not going to be true until I do what? Until I do that, then that'll close this contact. It'll let it go through, and it would seal in.
So when they say examine if, that's the same thing as true?
If it, we could change that to say, okay, it's true when it's open, okay, or it's true when it's closed.
Gotcha.
But they don't call it that. So this guy right here, we call this X for examine because they don't want to put E. We call this examine if open. And this symbol right here, this is the examine if closed. Now the problem is I'm using a normally open push button for a stop button. What's wrong with using a normally open push button for a stop button?
Should
I
hold it down?
No, I mean it's it says I'm true when I'm open, so it's as long as it's open, it's true. So the PL sees that just like this symbol right here. It sees that as being like that. It becomes false when I press it.
Okay.
So we're saying it's true if it's open. So if it's true, it's going to let the signal come through. But the problem is I'm using a, so here I'd come out here and I'd label this stop, and let's say I label this start. So what I'm doing, if I use that examine if open, it says it's true when it's open. That means I would use a normally open push button for a stop button. What's wrong with using a normally open push button for a stop button?
You have to like pull it out to stop it, you mean?
No, I could come up here and I press it. So if it's true when it's open, if I press it, it's going to become false. So right now, this is set just like this is. If I was to come up here and set this up, right now this would work. It would appear to work fine. But I would have to use a normally open push button for a stop button. And this book is notorious about this. If you did this out in industry, you wouldn't be programming PLC for long. Because what happens in industry all the time is these wires are exposed. These wires break. What would happen? Here's my 200 horsepower motor out there running. I'm using an examine if open instruction. Well, if the wire's open, it's open.
Wait, but I'm still confused about that. True would be closed.
No, true means examine if open. Period. It don't mean so. This is no. You're trying to say an open is a true. Computers, a true and a false is what you make them.
Oh.
So you can make a one. You can make a one false. It's up to you. So what this guy, what this instruction right here is.
But sometimes electricians will say true or false, right?
But they're talking about electricity.
Yeah, yeah.
They're talking about, yeah. And you're right. Okay. But the problem is that if I use, so if I say an examine if open, so I want my start button to start off true.
because we want the signal to flow through it. So if I use this thing with a line through it, which people, this is what gets electricians confused, because they say, well, that's a normally closed push button. Well, in electricity it is. Right? You understand that. But this is not electricity. This is a computer. In a computer, you determine what's true and false. Or this, you don't do it. This guy here does. So that instruction right there, a lot of people will call it a normally closed contact. And it's fine if you call it that, but you need to understand it is not a normally closed contact. It is an instruction in a program, and it is not a normally closed contact. It's true when it's open.
That throws me off.
I know it does. But it's kind of, and this gives the electricians problems, because they'll go out there and they'll use this. They'll come up here and they'll say, okay, I'm going to use that. And then they say, okay, I'm going to come out here and I'm going to wire this up.
You're talking about the stop button is true when it's open.
No, I'm talking, in this situation it is. But this is what the electrician would do. The electrician would draw that symbol inside the program. And then they would do what they're supposed to do. They'll come out here and they'll use one of the, they'll come out here and they'll connect one of these push buttons like that. So they come over here and they say, they use a, oops, sorry. Where's my drawing at?
Well, you could say when it's true, it's open.
Yeah, so what they do is they would come over here and they would come over here and use this guy right here. So they would use that, they would come over here and they would use this guy right here. And this is an examine if open, and they're using a normally closed switch, which is closed. So what happens is, here's your signal sitting right there. So now somebody would have to come over here and hold the stop button in, because it's true when it's open, to cause it to run. And this is the problem we have with electricians. So they know they're supposed to use a normally closed out there on the PLC. They know a stop button has to be a normally closed, according to OSHA, according to safety. And why? Because you want, if a wire breaks, you want the motor to stop. But the problem is, they come over here and they use the right switch right there. Then they come over here and they put that instruction right there, which says examine if open. Well, the switch is not open. The switch is what? Closed. It says it's true when it's open, but the switch is not open, it's closed. So it's going to be what? It's going to be false. And nothing would work. And what would they blame it on? Well, they blame it on a bad switch. They'd go out there and change switch out. They wouldn't even put a meter on it. They'd change switch out. And then they'd say, well, this switch is bad too. They'd change switch out. And then somebody's going to explain the difference in a PLC between an examine if open and an examine if closed.
So would you have to put the XIC
That's exactly right. This really gets confused. So if I was going to use a normally closed pushing button up there, then what I would do in my program, and this guy in this book, he makes his problem all the time, guys. You got to watch for it. I would actually use that instruction right there for a stop button inside a PLC program. Because this is, I examined if closed. Is the stop button closed?
Yes.
Yes. So it'd be true. So it'd come right through there. But this gets electricians screwed up, because they're used to drawing this as a normally closed contact. And this is not a normally closed contact. This is a push button. This is not a... So yeah, and this guy in this book makes this big mistake.
The author of the book.
The author of this book. He'll draw over here on his electrical side, he will draw a normally closed push button. And then he'll use an examine if open instruction inside his program. So that's why you need to learn these. This has nothing to do with contacts controlled by a simulated coil.
This has all the world to do with input devices that you have connected up to these ports. So normally, if you have a normally closed device, you'll use an examine if closed. This gets electricity.
But the symbol is the opposite on the computer part. What's the symbol for normally if closed? Open.
The symbol, this is why. So an electrician learns this as a normally if closed.
Right.
But this is this is what you need to learn in PLCs for an input. Don't worry about contacts within the program. Just worry about these input devices that you have hooked up. Do you want it to be true when it's open, or do you want it to be true if it's false? If it's true, if it's closed. So it's up to you. It has nothing to do. So if I came down here and made this makes no difference. That's a contact being controlled by. That's never even coming out. That's not even a true contact. Just software. And that's what gets electricians problems, is this is one of the big things that we... So this guy right here, now I don't know, if he called this a stop right there, then we got problems. If he's calling it a push button, we don't care. But is it a stop, or is it a... But that is what we call an examine if open instruction. It depends on the application. It's just what I'm saying is, if I have a button that's called a stop button, I better use an examine if closed instruction. And in that way, if the wire opens for some reason, then the device is going to stop.
Could you draw an example of where you would use an XIO?
Let me reestablish the communication with my PLC. I disconnected it. No wonder. That's why I couldn't download while it nope. It says I can't find it. So it says mine's on COM 5. So now I gotta figure out if we'll go ahead and do it. And then see if it's there. It is. Over there. So we'll come up here. We'll create a new program. We'll come down here and. So I've got a MicroLogic 1000B. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come up here. I'm going to put this examine. I'm going to start a new run, Rich. Start a new run, right? I'm going to come down here and put this contact right here. Okay. And then I'm going to come up here and put this guy right here. And then I'll come up. By the way, you can go ahead and create the run before you even... Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put this down drop, and then I'm going to take this guy. By the way, if you want to drag it, don't drag it by the top, drag it by the bottom. Then I can drag this and put it inside that. And then I'm going to pick another army contact right here. So this is my run. I'm going to assign this to input colon. 0/0 with this. We'll call this stop. I'm going to come here and assign this to input 0/1. We'll call this start. Here and assign this to an output. Output colon 0/0. And then I'm going to call this run. And then now that I've got that contact assigned, I can just come up here and call this run, and it should fill it. So, check for errors, looks okay. Come up here, I'm gonna download this. Call this start stop. And I see what you say about the PLC, but like I said, I'm saving all these on my server so they don't take up any disk space. Do I want to change the run mode? Because we got it in remote, yes. Do we want to go online? Now, when we go online with our program, what this is going to do, this is literally going to show you what contacts are true and what contacts are false. So this is a normally closed push button. So what I've done on my PLC program, let me bring my camera up. So this right here, it would be a normally open. This right here would be a normally closed, and this right here is a momentary contact. So my stop button is supposed to be normally closed, so I pushed it to the left. It's normally closed. And then I'm going to switch back to my program, and it says this is false. So nothing's happened. And I can come over here. Here's my momentary contact on one. So this is showing me what's active. But it says this guy right here is false. I can't get through that stop button. But over here, when I look at my camera, I've got this to the left, which is it's normally closed. So this would be a stop button. It's normally closed. But yet, it's not getting through my program, right? You understand? So I'm going to make it normally open, which is not good for a stop button, because now a wire could break, and I couldn't. So I could come up here and disconnect that wire going to my PLC, and it wouldn't work. Now I want to go back here and look at my program. It says it's true. So normally open, true. That's not good. That's not good for a stop button. Because now a wire could break. In fact, I could simulate this for you. I could hook up this circuit if I got my... And now the wire could break. I could disconnect that stop button. This sucker would come up here and it'd run forever. And now I can't stop this 200 horsepower motor out there because I use an examine if open instruction instead of an examine if closed. Now we'll go offline. And I'm just going to change this instruction type. So we just right click on it. Go to edit instruction. And I'm going to change this to examine if it's closed. And look, it automatically changed the symbol for me. Check it, looks like it's okay now. Okay. And then I'm gonna come up here and I'm gonna download it. Second time I've used this, so if you don't give it a revision, it'll automatically go to the next one. So if you keep doing this on programs, and you go and find this program, there's gonna be about 15 or 20 of them out there. So normally we just take this. Downloading program, switch to run mode, yes, and we want to go online so we can see what's going on. Run mode, do you want to go online? Yes. Okay. So now I'm using a normally open contact, and it shows that is false. I'm using a normally open push button. So there it's normally open. I'm going to close it. And then I'm going to go back to my program and it shows it's true. Because that is not a normally open. It's an examine if closed. It is true when it's closed. Well, a stop button is closed. So we want it to be true when it's closed. Now I can come over here and just touch my start button. I use it as a momentary contact and it sealed itself in. And how do I stop it? Well, I come over and just take my stop button, just flip it off and flip it back on. That's all there is to it. Now, this only applies to inputs. It doesn't apply to, I could come down here and I could insert another rung. I could come in here and I could put a normally closed contact, because I'm going to control this with that guy right there. This is not going to be in control. So I'm going to say run. Okay. And then I'll come up here and assign this to an output. So output 0/1. And we'll call this motor 1. Now this, we do them the way we call them. So when this guy's energized, this guy right here will be open. When this guy's de-energized, this guy right here will be closed. But this is simulated. This is not actually a push button. This is coming in from inside the PLC. Check it for errors real quick, even though I know it's free. I'm gonna come up here and download this. Give it a revision since I've changed it. By the way, so this says motor 1, but we don't have motors here. So what we do on your PLC, on your 1000s, you got 3 LEDs up there. I mean, not LEDs, you got 3 lights. On the 1100s, you got the lights out here on the panel. So this is output 0, this is output 1, so it's putting 24 volts out here, so whatever I hooked up there would be working. So I've got this closed. I'm going to come over here and just touch this. And then they switch positions. So contacts inside the program that's controlled by the program, those are fine to call them normally open and normally closed. And even if you call the inputs normally open and normally closed, that's okay with me. But if you change the instruction, if you look at the instruction, they don't call it a normally open, right? What do they call it? They call it examine if closed and examine if open. So I want that stop button to be true when it's closed. So I'm using that symbol right there. But this book makes a big mistake on this several times. Just telling me I got a new version for my camera program.
Can you switch the button?
So right now this relay is energized. Since this relay is energized, all its normally closed contacts are open. So if this is energized, this is open. It's being controlled by that relay cord. If I come over here and stop it.
So, okay, I see it.
Yeah. Now this is a normally closed contact. It's not connected to an input. It's being controlled by this coil right here. So that's the biggest problem we have. And this guy, like I said, this guy that wrote this book will draw a normally closed push button on his diagram. And then he'll use an examine if closed instruction. I'm sorry, he'll use an examine if open instruction. And it never works.
Is it because the electrical wiring diagram is shown live?
The electrical diagram is drawn the way it's connected. So right. this is the electrical diagrams for the Amatro line. And we could look at the Festo line too. It's just. So you have the electrical symbols, which is the way you draw them when you hook them up. So that's a normally open, by the way, these are ISO symbols, these are international symbols, so the symbols change a little bit. Over here we use what we call an ANSI symbols, which is the American National Standard Institute. The international, the ISO symbols, they don't use two contacts like we do. So this is a normally open, this is a normally closed, it's stop. So inside the PLC program, it's got to be a stop button, right? You understand, it needs to be normally closed. Then I got to use a normally, I got to use an examinative closed instruction. But all these symbols are the actual symbols for the device. So this is a magnetic sensor, this is a magnetic sensor, this is a magnetic sensor, this is a magnetic sensor. This comes down to, this guy right here connects to input 1.2. This would be the second input, third input, fourth input, fifth input, sixth input, seventh input on the PLC. So on the electrical symbols, how you connect, you use the actual electrical symbols. Inside the PLC program, so these are the programs for the, I don't have them run off for the, so this is the programs for the I know we went past our break, guys, but y'all asked some really good questions, I see. Outfit program. Oh, I remember. They're down here now. Here, basically, we have symbols. Over there, the symbols that we use in the PLC program are a lot less than the number of symbols that we use in the electrical. So when you wire the electrical connection, you use the symbols used by your plant. But those are pretty standard too. I don't know if I think I closed that out. So here's an instruction without an input. So outputs are required, inputs are not. In this class we'll have inputs. So every time this thing scans, then this run right here would be true. We call this unconditional. So this is actually the PLC programs that run on the Festo line. This is just a section of it. So on the electrical, so when you do your electrical, you're going to have to draw the symbols for those devices. Of course, here we're going to use standard symbols. So somewhere, we're going to use ANSI symbols, so somewhere on your reference material inside of the Blackboard site, you should see symbols. Is this it? Course content. Then, course reference material. So these are what you would actually use on the wiring. These are the symbols you would have to use on the wiring. Pressure switches, flow switches, or liquid level switches, temperature switches, flow switches.
And then the push buttons, normally open push buttons.
Normally closed. And normally we don't have a contact on the input, but we could.
The guy doesn't give the right symbols for motors, by the way.
These are lamps. So these are up there.
The book's not right on the motors?
Yeah, they give he gives a funky signal. You see the symbol he gives where you got the thing and he's got the two spinning things.
It's a regular circle, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, a DC motor, I don't see a DC motor. So AC motors, these are the symbols. So this would be a single phase, this would be a three phase. And we don't take a wound rotor motor, but that's but the symbol that he's using for a motor is a fan motor. So a DC motor basically has a simple symbol. A DC motor, and it's a little more to this, but for this class, we'll just use. So a DC motor, we have two little squares right here. We put a circle and we put a square on the other side. This is the DC motor. It's actually the armature or the rotor, which is usually what we control when we turn the DC motor on. And then this would be a single phase AC motor, and this would be a three phase AC motor. Which I don't think we're doing these. By the way, we normally wouldn't control a motor with a PLC. What we do is we would come over here and take our output. So let's say output 0/0, and then we would hook that to a relay coil. This would be a relay, and then over here in the power section, we need to give that a name, don't we? According, if you use a double brake, if it's up to you, then this would come down, say, to the single phase motor. And one. So normally what we do on motors is we use the PLC to bring in a relay, and then we let the relay run the motor. So the only motors you would hook up to a PLC would be like a little fractional horsepower DC motor, maybe. Like a fan. Normally we run these with relays. Establish communication. Here. So what will be, these are the two interfaces. And y'all see me set some of those up. The instructions are in here if you ever have to do that. So everybody okay on what we call syncing and sourcing? So to get current to flow, we have to, if we're dealing with DC, so syncing and sourcing only deals with DCs. This is becoming very, very prominent in PLCs. 24 volts DC. Every PLC that we have in here, the inputs run off of 24 volts DC. So we got two options on some PLCs. Some of these are fixed. This would be the common for the input ports on the PLC. This would be the common for the input device itself that I've got drawn as just squares. Because those could be push buttons, those could be switches, they could be sensors, they could be a lot of different things. So if I make this plus, then what does this over here have to be to allow current to flow? It's gotta be minus. Well, what we would say is we'd say the inputs,
So in PLCs, if it uses plus for a common for the device, we call that sourcing. If it uses minus, we call that syncing. So here the PLC itself would be sourcing. So it means all my input devices would be what?
Syncing.
No. If you look at the, and you can look at both these PLCs, you can see a little better on the 1000. Inputs up here, you see it's got two commons. It says DC common. That is whatever you want it to be. So if you put plus up there, then it's syncing. I mean, if you put a plus up there, then it's sourcing. If you put a minus up there, it's syncing. Now the predominant method in the United States, and I think this is even in German companies, most often you're going to see this. You're going to see the PLCs use a minus common. So my PLC inputs are going to be what? Syncing. And that means all these output, all these inputs that I run, we'll have to make sure we hook up those sourcing loops. So this trainer is available. So right now, if I wanted to hook up an input, I'd have to hook up a common wire to this red thing right here. So right here, I'd have to hook up a wire right here and I'd run it to every input device. Now the problem is push buttons don't care, sensors do. So when you buy these DC sensors, these electronic sensors, you either got to buy syncing or sourcing. So you better know your PLCs, because if you buy a syncing sensor and you hook it up to a syncing input, they're not going to work. Everybody understand that? Because you get minus and minus. So it's very important to know. In some PLCs, you buy the 314s, the Siemens 314s, you can't change that. Those things are syncing inputs. So that means you need to know that, right? Because if you bought a syncing sensor, then you'd be in trouble. And the predominant way, and these are the way these are wired, so these I can change it. I can change this. If you look at the bottom, you see every output has a common, if you're looking at the 1100s, and also the 1000s. But you see a jumper, jumping all of them. You can tell this one. You can see the little red wire coming in all the way on the right. So while we're running, this is the predominant over here. This is plus. So on the outputs, this is plus. So all my output devices have to use what as a common, a minus. So all our PLCs in here is wired up like this. Now on sensors, we're not going to explain why, but an NPN sensor, this is a sourcing sensor. I'm sorry, this is a syncing sensor. And a PNP sensor is a sourcing sensor. I might have that backwards. So here's what we're talking about. So normally we establish the common. Sometimes a PLC will have a DC power supply on it. So if you look at the Micrologics, and I think it's also on the 1000, if I can get it up there. This has a DC output. I'm not using it, but I could. This is usually dedicated to push buttons. So push buttons require no current. The only current that's drawn is by the input itself. So if I look right here, I've got a DC plus and a DC minus. So this has a DC power supply built into it. And you see I'm not connecting anything to it, because the current on that is usually very limited. If you have a lot, if you have a bunch of solid state sensors, you would very easily exceed the rating of that DC, that power supply. So what I'm using is I'm using the external power supply, this guy right here. So this has an external power supply built into it. That's where we have, here's our plus. By the way, Germans, they use red for plus, just like we do, but they use blue for minus. They don't use black. It's, imagine most countries, and this is true on the PLC, by the way. So if we looked at all our, if we looked at all these PLCs out there, they're not, on all these lines, they're not using the internal power supply. They're using an external power supply. And so if we measure these commons up here, so if I took an ohm meter, let's see if I can pull it in. So if I took my meter and measured it between these commons here down to the blue one, it would measure 0 volts because that's the common. And then if I was to go here down to blue, then it would measure 24 volts. So we have these wired up for sourcing, syncing inputs and sourcing outputs. So if we go back and look at these PLCs, we'll see that one of the screws is called common. You can hook it up to the internal power supply, or you can hook up an external power supply. Normally, they don't use the internal power supply unless all you got is push buttons. If you got push buttons, that's no big deal, guys, or mechanical switches. If you got solid state, as soon as you say solid state, you mean these guys are going to require current. They're going to require power, which means odds are that's what you'll run into out there, which means you're going to have an external power supply. But it's up to you to establish what is actual common, whether it's sinking or sourcing. It's just that you come in and you, that's not true. If you got a sinking input, then what you would have to do is you'd have to run the minus to your, you'd have to run the minus to your PLC, and you'd run the plus on your external power supply out to your devices. So it's going to get you to draw these things, and unfortunately, I don't see, let's see if I've got the way it's in the book. So this is the way your lab book is drawn up. So the problem is, it says we have 120 volts DC on my common. So what are you going to do? You're going to come over and mark this out, and you're going to call this what? Common, which is what it is. That's truly what it is. Then what we do is we have to establish the common. So if I'm running syncing inputs, then I'll take this line right here. I'm going to extend it up, guys, so I can draw my symbol. Then what I would do is, by the way, the true symbol, the line is there, so the true symbol would actually look like this. Dang it. I'll be there in a minute. This is the way your PLC hooks up. And this is plus 24 volts. Oh, it's 24 volts. I shouldn't put the plus on the negative side here. Now, this is okay, but they don't tell us what common is. So if you're on the 1100s, you'll come in here and you'll draw this in here. Oops. And I'm recording this too. So this sets up our output as what? Sourcing. It sets up our inputs as syncing. Now this is for the 1100s. For the 1000s, what you'll do on the 1000s, and y'all got to be careful, guys, because this guy right here, if you're on the 1000s, this guy uses this. This is a symbol for AC, and it's 120 volts AC. For the 1000s. So the 1000s are using AC outputs. So syncing and sourcing on AC makes no difference. The only thing syncing and sourcing really applies to are for the DC. So both PLCs run syncing inputs, and then the 1100s run sourcing outputs, and the 1000 run AC outputs. So you'll need to mark these out and put them in there according to what PLC use. So on the 1000s, if it's turned on, don't open up the little flap on the bottom. That's 120 volts down there. And it will shock you. 1100s, we only got 24 volts, and of course the outputs are not covered. So the 1000s, the actual outputs are covered up there. So make sure you don't you can actually see where they established the common. You can actually see it jump. And mine's not plugged in, so I can open it up. They bring L2, which is considered to be the neutral. They jump it over to each common. So it's coming right off the 120 volt AC input. So just do what? Just leave that little flap closed. Open the close of it, but you're in the 1000 if you'll get shot. These are 24 volts, and you can actually see where they established the common here, but you don't know. So here they're actually using the DC power supply. So it's got 24 volts because all they have over here is push buttons. So we don't have any real sensors, we have push buttons. The only problem we have is all these are normally open. So that means if you need to use a normally closed, you're going to have to use one of these selector switches over here. And you just do it like that, and that'll leave it on. That'll make it simulate a normally closed. Since these are nothing but push buttons, then they can run this off the DC power supply. But you'll see, it's got, so the positive goes out here somewhere, but they take the negative 24 volts, and then it jumps to the common, and then it jumps to the common. So that means you can see on the 1000 that these guys right here are definitely running syncing inputs, because you can actually see the miners jumping over. And like I said, you won't see many PLCs unless they're running nothing but push buttons. If you see them running any solid state sensors, then odds are they'll have an external power supply. And we won't talk about force right now. We'll do that next. So what we're ready to come in, and we're ready. Let's go back and let me pause this. Let's go back and look.